dear friends, fellow workers. I have often said, and long thought, that to change the public's mind on any important question takes 100 years. And the truth cannot be forced upon stubborn human nature, but it must be led slowly into the light. However, in the words of Victor Hugo, there is one thing stronger than any king or army, and that is an idea whose time to move has come. I was born Kerry Clinton Lane, January 9th, 1859. And on that date, the conditions under which most women lived were deplorable. I'm sure that it must be very difficult for many of you to even imagine them. If you had been a married woman who owned your own property, you would have had the right to control that property in only 6 American states. Upon your death, you could have willed that property to others in 14 states, although you could have had none of its income whilst you lived. Only 3 states would have granted you the right, if you were married, to collect and use your own wages, and you would not have been permitted to be the guardian or even co-guardian of your own children. Just 20 years before I was born, no college in the world was open to women. The popular view of what should be taught to women had been written by the French philosopher Rousseau in 1762. And it was a view that was long in dying. This is what he said about the education of women relative to men. To please us, to be useful to us, to make us love and esteem them, to educate us when young, to take care of us when grown, to advise us, to console us, to render our lives easy and agreeable. These are the duties of women at all times, and what they should be taught from their infancy. In many American states and in other countries, a husband had the legal right to beat his wife, as long as the stick he used was no larger than the diameter of his own thumb. And of course, no woman could legally change any of these abuses, even in our democratic society, for she lacked the power to make her wishes known through the ballot box. There were women working to bring about change. And in the year in which I was born, an organized women's rights movement was already 11 years old. 2 friends, Elizabeth Stanton and Lucretia Mott, resolved to call a women's rights convention in Seneca Falls, New York, where they lived. A handful of women met, despite ridicule in the press and condemnation by the public. And they looked at the Declaration of Independence for guidance as to how best to express their views. And then they issued a proclamation which began, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men and women are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." 6 rights were listed at Seneca Falls, and that handful of women began working on all of them. The right of girls to obtain an education, the right of women to qualify for the professions, the right of women to control their own property, to make a will, to control their own wages, and the right of women to vote. Now, one of the colors by which this organization came to be known was yellow, the color of sunshine, light, and knowledge. And our symbol was a flower, the yellow rose of suffrage. From the time I was 27, I worked to win women the right to vote, oftentimes without much sign of progress or hope. But then in 1890, a thunderbolt struck, and its name was Wyoming. When I was a little girl, Wyoming was a part of what was called the Great American Desert. And then shortly after the Civil War, the Union Pacific Railway put down tracks along that territory, and a small circle of tents sprung up at its last stop, called Cheyenne. Well, 2 years later, that territory of Wyoming organized. And its territorial senate passed, by a vote of 5 ayes, 2 nays, and 1 absent, a woman's suffrage bill, giving the women of the Wyoming Territory the right to vote. And the governor of that territory said he signed that bill as gladly as Abraham Lincoln had written his name on the Emancipation Proclamation. Well, 18 years later, that territory of Wyoming applied for statehood. And there was a fierce battle in our Congress over whether Wyoming should be allowed to be admitted to the Union with women's suffrage in its constitution. That debate raged for days. And the popular view, as expressed by one senator, was, well, I say, let woman remain in the realm in which God and the Bible hath assigned her. Now, that debate grew so heated and so opposed to the admission of Wyoming giving its women the right to vote, the delegate James Carey telegraphed the Wyoming legislature to ask for advice. And back came this reply from the men of the Wyoming legislature. We will remain out of the Union 100 years rather than to enter it without women's suffrage. Our Congress finally capitulated. And in 1890, the Bill of Admission was passed, and Wyoming became the first state to give the right to vote to its women. The first place anywhere in the world. That same year, I went for the first time to the National Suffrage Meeting in Washington, D.C. Our leader was Susan B. Anthony, and she was presented with a bouquet of 70 yellow roses, one for each year of her age. Oh, her hair may have been white, but she was ready to fight to win a second state for women's suffrage, and she asked for volunteers to go with her to help to win that second state, the state of South Dakota. She got very few volunteers. Miss Anthony, I will go with you. My name is Carrie Lane Chapman, Miss Anthony, and I will go with you and work from September until Election Day. Conditions in South Dakota were even worse than I could have imagined. I would disembark from the train, often to discover that the depot was the only building in sight. And it contained only a stove and a spittoon. I might wait for hours, often hungry as well, for of course there was no place to eat. And then suddenly I might see on the treeless horizon a cloud of dust, someone in a wagon coming to collect me. I spoke in barns, in grain elevators, under a canvas in the middle of a field. And once, when there was no other place, I climbed into an open wagon in front of a post office. I had a small boy ring a bell to attract attention, and I began. If independence and self-reliance are qualifications for the ballot, the women of South Dakota deserve enfranchisement. I have recently been a guest at the home of a widow in your state. All day she spent in the field pitching hay, and when dusk fell, she returned to the house to prepare supper for herself, for me, and for her five children. When the dishes were washed, she went to the barn where she milked all of the cows. And then she harnessed the team and drove us all 2.5 miles to the schoolhouse where I was to speak. When my lecture was done, she drove us all home. She put the team in the barn and each of her five children to bed. Now that widow owns 120 acres. It is in the drought district and it has a mortgage on it. And she is struggling against the tide in an effort to support herself and her five children. She wants to vote. Is there a man so unjust he would deny her that privilege? I knew, of course, that we did not stand a ghost of a show for success. We were winning women to want to vote by the hundreds, but we were having no appreciable effect upon the men. But on election day in 1890, in the state of South Dakota, 22,072 men did vote yes. But we lost by a margin of 2-1. Shortly before Christmas, I returned to my husband, George, exhausted in mind and body. And a few months later, contracted typhoid fever. It was months before I was able to be moved. And in my delirium, I gave that speech from the South Dakota campaign over and over and over again. You know, when I had been a little girl on the farm, I had prayed nightly for many years for curly hair. Well, finally that childish prayer came true, for all of my hair fell out, and when it grew back, it was curly. We must be very careful what we pray for. I suppose that some of you may wonder why I continued to work for women's suffrage. I suppose that it all goes back to my belief in the perfectibility of the human race. You know, when I heard of the death of Amelia Earhart, I did wonder if when the end came, she felt that what she had attempted was worth dying for. You see, to me, the chief end of every one of us is to build a good society. I suppose, in a way, it is like that story of the two frogs who fall into the milk pail. And one of those frogs is an optimist, and one of those frogs is a pessimist. And that pessimist frog, she gives up, and she dies. But that optimist frog, she keeps working and struggling, and struggling and working and struggling until she churns a fine pot of butter. And then she crawls out and hops away. But finally it came. Our amendment had been written many decades before, and it was brief and to the point. It said, "The right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or any state on account of sex." And finally, on August 26th, 1920, at 8 o'clock in the morning, in the privacy of his own home, Secretary of State Colby signed into law the 19th Amendment of the Constitution of the United States of America. And that afternoon, I stood for the last time in front of some of the hundreds of women and men who had worked to win the right to vote for the women of the United States. This is a great, a glorious day. For many a long year, we have marched up that hill together, you and I. But now we must go our separate ways, but always holding in our hearts tender memories of our comrades in that great war. Money for the cause was usually given at a sacrifice, and thousands of women and men went without things they wanted and could have had in order to win the right to vote for you. Women have undergone agony of soul, which you may never comprehend, in order that you and your daughters might inherit political freedom. That vote has been costly. Prize. Over 70 years, the battle for that single privilege was waged. But I do believe that the secret for a long and happy life is devotion to something that causes forgetfulness of self. And reformers tend to lead very long lives. And I was invited to go back to where it all started, to Wyoming, to the university there, to make the commencement address, the first woman ever to be asked to do so. And I was proud to accept. Edmund Burke has written that civilization is a contract between the dead, the living, and the unborn. Now we must all go forth, determined to become a part of that great contract, determined to become men and women of vision. Now vision is defined as a conviction based upon reliable knowledge. So this means we must all learn to think things through. We must learn to make the big things look big, and the small things look small. And then, when our conviction comes, vision will come with it, and then we can take our stand. Victor Hugo has written, "Abuses existed. I combated them. Tyrannies existed. I destroyed them. But rights and privileges existed, and I proclaimed and professed them." We are the state. If our laws fail to protect, it is we who fail. If injustice dwells in our great land, it is we who must hang our heads in shame. To the young women graduates, emancipation is not completed with the extension of suffrage. You must fight forward bravely and with great understanding. And to you all, so live your life that at its end, you do not regret that you have only learned to fight when life is drawing to its close. Remember, to the wrong that needs resistance, to the right that needs assistance, to the future in the distance, we must all give ourselves. God bless you, dear friends. fellow workers. God bless you all.